English as tuppence, changing yet changeless as canal water, nestling in green nowhere, armoured and effete, bold flag-bearer, lotus-fed Miss Havisham-bling Opsimath and Eremite, feudal still reactionary Rawlinson End. The story so far. The body of Doris Hazard's Pekingese, unwittingly asphyxiated beneath her husband's bottom during a wine and middle-aged spread do at the Great House, after the ritual fortnight in the Rawlinson fridge, has been given over to old Scrotum the wrinkled retainer for indecent burial under Sir Henry's giant marrow. This monstrous jade zebra veg is the master's puffed pride, and by his stern instruction, the greedy gourd is daily drip-fed with a powerful laxative. Thus,
should some rascal half-inch the blessed thing and eat it, it'll give him the licorice for weeks.
Now think on't. Dot, 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 dot. Great Aunt Florrie, toast crumbs specking the fine hairs gracing her upper lip, teacup half-empty, lukewarm in her lap, dozed in a cosy Chippendale settle. An elfin tissue curdled her mind with muted chimera. Through dancing dark, neon-bright saraband eels, gauzes of filmy Fellini, glimpses further than the rocket fathoms, rhythmic, fading, and in unending procession. It was chill, but a beautiful morning. During the night, soft snow mattressed the vast acreage of Rawlinson, yet defiant, hoyden heralds thrust emerald from the woodlands and window boxes of nearby Concreton. Outside, icicles crystalline and lovely pendant from his nose, old Scrotum the wrinkled retainer scrunched up the gravel whistling a dirty song. And Florrie, gentle corset prisoner of the flesh, started and was alert as a skinless eye when the old man, his russet-burned country face smiling in wreaths, pushed open the back door.
"Morning, ma'am," he wheezed. "I filled in the grave nice."
Florrie nodded and indicated the sink. "Perhaps you'd care to wash your hands?"
No, thank you, mum. I already did that up against a tree afore I came in here."
Florrie took a careful purse-slip sip of now cold tea. "Very well," she said, dabbing the corners of her mouth with a lavender-scented hanky. "Now, I'd like you to set up the card table and put down some sawdust in the smoking room. Lord Tarquin Portly and the Lady Philippa of Staines are popping over this evening." The wrinkled retainer hung up his greasy fez on a peg, and with joints crackling like the screwing up of plastic egg cartons, hacked and thricketed his way out into the hall. A pale sun poked impudent marmalade fingers through the grizzled lattice glass and sent the shadows scurrying like convent girls menaced by a tramp. Alone again, Florrie focused on the copper-gleaming coal scuttle, fogged, wool-gathered, and in seconds surrendered to Erewhon. Peacefully, on tiptoe through grey spheres where shade has substance, whispers walk and Maya reigns.